Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. I'm not a hematologist, neither I am a microbiologist, neither I am a pathologist. Today we'll be discussing on very interesting topic, that is ion panel, or we call ion study. I've selected this topic because good number of time we do prescribe or we do advise ion study, and we are not understanding very well why we are ordering and what will be the interpretation. Good number of time we don't advise when it is necessary. Hence, we do not come to the exact diagnosis in case of anemias, and we don't treat them properly. So from that point of view, I've selected this topic. All my videos lecture are for educative purpose. If you like the video, please press button like, subscribe the video, and also share with your friends to whom you consider that it may be beneficial. You will come across good number of time a person with anemia and you are treating, he is not getting results. In those particular group of people, this study will be very, very helpful. So let us begin with what we call as an ion study, or we call ion panel. So importance of ion study, or we call ion panel or ion profile, which will include ion level in blood, TIBC, or we call transferrin level, ferritin level, that is storage of ion, we call saturation of ion, or we call transferrin saturation. There is one another value, usually this is never being calculated, but sometime it can be of help. We call unsaturated ion binding capacity. Then there is one another we call transferrin, which is indirectly parallel with TIBC. And then you can calculate even transferrin saturation. Out of these three, that is ion level, TIBC and ferritin, these three are the most important value, and from there you can calculate ion saturation, you can calculate UIBC, etc. So we'll be going through those, how it helps you in your everyday practice. So normally when you ask for an ion panel, so ion level is given, TIBC level is given, and ferritin is given, and we calculate transferrin saturation. The report gives you directly, but you can calculate transferrin saturation. So ideally these three are the basic reports, and this is being calculated report. So you try to look at those figure and the reference value are given. Because this is a ready-made report, usually we don't pay much attention. We just look at ion level is normal or high or normal or low. Here you can see that ion level is low. So it suggests in favor of ion deficiency. And if you see that transferrin level is on the higher side, TIBC is on the higher side. That suggests that the ion is low in your blood, and that's why transport protein is free. So ion binding capacity is increased. And if you look at the ferritin level, so what we call is a storehouse, storage capacity or stores has been reduced. This is classical what we call as ion deficiency anemia. But in that particular group, you can calculate unsaturated ion binding capacity, that is TIBC 588 minus 42. So that can help you in some of the condition. You can calculate iron saturation, that is 42 divided by 588 multiplied by 100. So you can calculate iron saturation. There is one more thing which is occasionally being advised, that is called hepcidin. And this is very, very important to differentiate between what we call as a hemochromatosis, that is iron overload, which can be genetic, or you can have iron overload because of other mechanisms. And in those particular group of conditions, hepcidin level may be off head. So normally iron panel is indicated in what we call as anytime if you advise CBC, and in CBC you get microcytic hypochromic anemia. Ideally, you should ask for an iron profile and you should go for the study. By and large, if clinically, if we make a diagnosis that this is iron deficiency anemia, usually we don't ask for iron panel because it is costly. But it gives you a lot of idea regarding all these different varieties. It can differentiate iron deficiency from anemia of chronic disease, thalassemia trait, and even sideroblastic anemia. All this can give rise to microcytic hypochromic anemia, and there are others also like lead toxicity, etc. There's another group which can be also benefited by identifying iron overload. We call storage, excessive iron storage, and that comes in hemochromatosis. And it can be there also in a person who is thalassemia major and who needs multiple blood transfusion. And because of multiple blood transfusion, there is an iron overload. So in that particular, iron study panel will be very, very beneficial to find out the amount of iron overload. So if you want to understand why this panel is asked, what is the importance of that each value, we are going brushing up very fast regarding the iron metabolism, that is iron absorption, transport and storage. Whatever iron you take in oral cavity, whether it is in ferrous form or ferric form, so that particular goes into stomach. Ferric form has to be converted into ferrous form in presence of hydrochloric acid and if vitamin C is available. So vitamin C helps in conversion of ferric into ferrous form. That will be absorbed by gastroferritin into stomach mucosa. From there, it will be transported. And in duodenum also, it will help to absorb that iron. So maximum iron is absorbed in first part of duodenum. From there, it is delivered into blood. In blood, it combines with apoferritin and it is converted into transferrin. And it is transported to liver, bone marrow, spleen. In reticuloendothelial system, it is stored in the form of ferritin. In liver also, it is stored in the form of ferritin. In a bone marrow, it is also stored in the form of ferritin. So ferritin is a storehouse, which is for a short period. But when it is stored for a long period, we call it as a hemosiderin. And when excessive hemosiderin is being deposited, we call that as hemosiderosis. And when it starts producing toxic damage because of excessive collection, we call that as hemochromatosis. Now this particular iron transferrin is a plasma iron binding protein. So it combines with iron and then it is transported and delivered to liver, bone marrow and spleen, reticuloendothelial system, macrophages. And iron binds to apoferritin and it is converted into ferritin as a storehouse. And whenever it is required, it is delivered. And this particular ion is utilized to manufacture hemoglobin, myoglobin and certain enzymes. This is in short what we call as an iron metabolism. So whatever iron is taken in the diet will be converted into ferric to ferrous form in small intestine, in stomach. In first part of duodenum it will be absorbed by the help of gastroferritin and it will be transported to bone marrow where you will have iron utilization to manufacture heme and hemoglobin and RBC will appear in blood. Also this transferrin will be delivered to liver for storage in the form of ferritin. A old RBC will be destroyed by spleen and after destruction from hemoglobin iron will be available and that will be again delivered back to bone marrow. And whenever you require iron from liver also it will be delivered. There is one material which is we call as a hepcidin. Hepcidin will control, it is a master control for iron. So if hepcidin level increases, it inhibits the delivery of iron from macrophages present in bone marrow and liver, as well as it inhibits the absorption of iron from intestine. And this will decrease the iron level in blood. And opposite of that, we have got one slide, we'll be showing you in that slide, that whenever a hepcidin level is reduced, hepcidin is manufactured in liver. And if hepcidin level is reduced, iron absorption from intestine will increase. Iron delivery to manufacture heme will increase. And iron from liver will be also delivered by a macrophages releasing iron. So low hepcidin increases the iron level, high hepcidin decreases the iron level, in short. This is again the same. So iron absorption, transport, stored in the form of ferritin and hemosiderin. It is utilized for myoglobin, hemoglobin and enzyme. There is small quantity of loss of iron by means of urine, sweat, feces and mainly by desquamation and in female by loss of blood during menstrual period. And RBC formation takes place in the marrow by erythropoiesis and old RBC are destroyed by RS system in spleen and then it is delivered back in the form of a plasma transferrin by plasma protein in the form of iron and that is delivered back again to bone marrow, spleen and liver. And this is how iron metabolism continues. In average healthy individual, about 3500 milligram of iron is stored and in women 2500 approximately, of which hemoglobin will be having nearly 2100 milligram of iron, myoglobin will be 300, enzymes will be containing only 50 milligram of iron. And in storage, it is almost 1000 milligram. And our daily requirement is around 1 milligram. And storage is in the form of a three main compound, ferritin, hemosiderin, and apoferritin. So main storage is ferritin and second mode of storage is hemosiderin. This is short period, this is for long period. So transferrin is a plasma ion transporter protein, while ferritin is an intracellular storage ion, which is for temporary purpose or short-term storage pool, while hemosiderin is for a long-term storage pool. So if you consider the ion protein, transport protein is transferrin, ferritin is stored in RA system, bone marrow macrophages, liver macrophages, and in spleen also. In spleen, it is less quantity, maximum is in liver and bone marrow. And ferroportin is also one type of a transport protein which is present in GI tract, mainly in duodenal mucosa and gastric mucosa, and that allows the ferric form of iron to be delivered. And hepcidin is a protein which is being manufactured by liver, and it takes part in regulation of iron balance in blood. So TIBC is a total iron binding capacity. Indirectly, it is like an iron cube tray. And transferrin is a protein which is going to transport iron to and fro. So it is like a taxi. So transferrin is a transport protein, and the amount of binding capacity, that we call as a cube tray. Serum iron is like calculating glucose level or triglyceride level in blood. So it is amount of iron present in blood. And ferritin is a storehouse. It is like HbA1c. So ferritin is a storage iron. Serum iron is a iron which is present in blood. Transferrin is the transport protein, but usually we calculate TIBC, which is parallel with transferrin. So TIBC is the total iron binding capacity. Indirectly, you are calculating transferrin only, but it is the iron binding capacity which you are calculating, total iron binding capacity. So it is amount of empty ice cube tray, empty spaces in ice cube you are calculating. So it is indirectly giving you an idea regarding a transferrin. So that is TIBC. So mainly we look at the three value: serum iron, ferritin. Serum iron is amount of iron present in blood. Ferritin is storage iron. And TIBC is a transport protein calculation. So serum iron is going to combine with transferrin to become a ferritin, which is stored in different area like liver and bone marrow, macrophages. So whatever amount of iron which is present in the blood, we calculate that, we call that as iron, serum iron level. So if serum iron level is reduced, it is classical in case of iron deficiency anemia, anemia of chronic disease, etc. And in case of iron overload, the serum iron level are elevated. This is a very simple way you can make out iron is lacking or iron is in excess. TIBC is serum total iron binding capacity, which is calculated by, because iron combines with transferrin, and this transferrin will be converted into ferritin. So if there is a free transferrin more, it indicates iron deficiency. So TIBC is always inversely proportional to ferritin level. So always remember, if ferritin level is low, TIBC will be high. So indirectly, it is giving you that how much amount of transport protein is free to bind with iron. So TIBC is always in opposite direction. Transferrin is a transport protein. So TIBC is indirectly a transport protein only. While ferritin is the amount of iron stored, that is locked in RA system. So ferritin is a storage protein, and that is bind with iron. And this particular ferritin level can be altered also in case of inflammation. That's why it is also called as an acute phase reactor. So it can give you a false interpretation regarding a ferritin level. So you have to keep it in mind, classical in case of a anemia of chronic disease, because good number of condition of chronic disease are inflammatory conditions. In that, ferritin level may be elevated because of inflammation, but not because of iron storage. So this should be kept in mind. And if this is stored in the form of hemosiderin, it will be seen by Persian blue stains, and that can be detected in a RBC also, in the form of a staining in RBC. We call hemosiderin pigments. And ferritin level will be markedly reduced in case of iron deficiency anemia. And that will be first, you will see the depletion of iron storehouse in a bone marrow, even before the iron deficiency anemia is detected by peripheral smear or on a clinical grounds. So bone marrow iron level will be very helpful. So bone marrow biopsy with iron staining will be very, very beneficial to detect them in a what we call as an early stage. So that is very important. And if there is an iron overload also, in that case also, bone marrow study, bone marrow iron staining will be very, very helpful. And ferritin level will be elevated also in case of a anemia of chronic disease, but you should always keep it in mind, it can be elevated secondary due to inflammation, due to interleukin 6. So it can give you false interpretation. Iron saturation is calculated value, or we call transferrin saturation, where you divide iron level by TIBC multiplied by 100. This will reduce, because iron level are reduced in iron deficiency, so the value will be low in iron deficiency, and because in the iron overload, the iron level will increase, so percentage saturation will be high in case of iron overload. So it is indirect way will help you, but if iron level are low, it will be always in favor of iron deficiency. And if iron level in blood, or what you call serum, is elevated, it is usually in favor of iron overload. As we were talking about hepcidin, hepcidin is manufactured in liver. If iron level is reduced, hepcidin level are also reduced. And once the hepcidin level are reduced, hepcidin, which was inhibiting at the level of GI tract, that will go. So iron absorption from GI tract will increase. The iron release, which was inhibited from macrophages, that is liver macrophages and bone marrow macrophages, will be delivered. So iron will be now delivered for use of hemoglobin synthesis, myoglobin synthesis and enzymes, etc. So there will be release of iron from macrophages. There will be increased absorption from GI tract. And there will be increased utilization of iron by bone marrow for manufacture of hemoglobin in RBC. This will happen if a person's iron level is reduced. And that is one of the beneficial effects. But in case of an iron overload, hepcidin level is also elevated. And that hepcidin level will inhibit at the level of GI tract as well as at the level of macrophages. And thus, it will reduce the iron level in blood. Also, inflammatory mediators like interleukin 6 will also stimulate hepcidin level. And that will increase iron level in blood. Even some of the bacteria will also stimulate increased level of hepcidin. And there is one gene which will increase the level of HFE protein, which will increase the hepcidin level. Because hepcidin level is increased, the iron storage will increase. And this happens in case of hemochromatosis. And in case of iron deficiency anemia, we have already shown you, hepcidin level will be low. So absorption from GI tract will increase. Absorption is increased, so iron level will be increased. So deficiency will be corrected. and from reticuloendothelial system, that is storage house, from ferritin, ion will be released and that will be utilized. And so ion deficiency will be corrected. While in a iron low overload, hepcidin level is elevated, which will inhibit absorption from GI tract and release of iron from macrophages of liver and macrophages of bone marrow. So absorption of new iron will depend upon the total iron storage of the body. And there is one gene which is called HFE gene, and that is acting via hepcidin level. So when hepcidin prevents more iron from getting absorbed, so enterocytes with excess of iron will be shed into stool, and that will be managing what we call as balance of iron. So hepcidin is considered as the main regulator for iron balance in body. Now, what will happen if the iron level in the blood increases? There is something called as a Fenton reaction. Because of this Fenton reaction, if iron is left free, it gives rise to hydroxyl molecule. So free radicals are released, and this is toxic to the cells. And that can give rise to what we call as damage to the cell, which happens in case of hemochromatosis. Now here, there is one patient whose blood test was done. TIBC level was 420, iron level was 90. Calculate the level of UIBC in this patient. So UIBC is TIBC minus iron, 420 minus 90 is equal to 330. Now, usually we don't utilize this at all. This particular value, we call it as unsaturated iron binding capacity, is just opposite of TIBC. So if you want to calculate iron saturation, that is transferrin saturation, so iron divided by TIBC multiplied by 100 comes to around 21. So this is reduced. So there is reduction in iron level in blood, that is iron saturation is reduced. Now there is another report which was given. One patient had this value, second patient had this value, patient 3 had this value. If you look at the iron level, see here, it is markedly elevated. So this has to be iron overload. And if you look here, it is 32, it is reduced. So this can be iron deficiency. So by looking at the iron level, it helps a lot. Then you can look at what we call as a saturation level. Here you can see that saturation is elevated. Here saturation is markedly reduced. So this is bound to be iron deficiency anemia. This is bound to be what we call as an iron overload. And then if you look further, ferritin level, storehouse is reduced. Here storehouse is normal. You can see that it is normal. Ferritin level is normal. So this value will help in iron deficiency anemia. And you can see here, it is normal. All value, TIBC is normal, UIBC is normal, iron level is normal, iron saturation is normal. So this is normal patient. So this is normal. Here you can see that ferritin level is low, TIBC is high. So whenever the TIBC, if it is increased, and iron level and iron saturation, as well as what we call as a ferritin level, if it is low, only TIBC is in opposite direction. Think in terms of iron deficiency anemia. While if TIBC is normal, iron level are elevated, iron saturation is elevated, think in terms of iron overload. Classical in case of iron deficiency anemia, MCV will be low, MCH will be reduced, MCHC will be also reduced, iron level will be reduced, only TIBC will be elevated, saturation will be low, ferritin level will be low. So we say that TIBC, if it is in opposite direction of iron level, it is in favor of iron deficiency anemia. RDW will be abnormal because of different shapes of RBC. reticulocyte count will be normal, platelet will be normal, WBC will be normal, and in peripheral smear you will get a hypochromic microcytic anemia, and you might see anisocytosis or poikilocytosis. And good number of time in iron deficiency anemia you can see even target cells. So do keep it in mind. TIBC is of importance. UIBC is usually not calculated. Hepcidin level also we don't calculate, but in iron deficiency anemia hepcidin will be inhibited, and because of inhibition of hepcidin there will be increased absorption from GI tract, and there will be release of iron from storehouse, that is ferritin, from macrophages of liver as well as macrophages in bone marrow, and iron saturation will be reduced. Usually good number of laboratory mention that in transferrin saturation, but if it is not mentioned you can calculate by iron divided by TIBC multiplied by 100. So it can be calculated, and if it is less than 13 it is very much in favor of iron deficiency anemia. Now another very easy way which is there to suspect and identify iron deficiency anemia, that if you replace the iron you get a response, positive response in a case of iron deficiency anemia. This is given in the form of 12 to 24 hours what will be the response after 48 hours, after 72 hours, after 30 days and after 1 month. But by and large when the iron therapy is given you will start getting improvement in iron level and ferritin level. This is a best slide which tells you regarding all the different varieties of microcytic hypochromic anemia and how you differentiate. So mainly three values are compared: ferritin, TIBC and iron. Now in iron deficiency anemia you can see the ferritin level is reduced, TIBC will be elevated, iron will be reduced. So only TIBC is elevated, and if you calculate the percentage it will be less than 13. Usually we say that less than 13 will be more in favor of iron deficiency anemia. In case of thalassemia all are nearly normal, but if you look at the basophil stipplings, it will be more in favor of thalassemia, and if you see target cells. Basophil stippling you can get also in case of lead toxicity. Anemia of chronic disease, ferritin usually is normal, but in case of an inflammatory pathophysiology, it may be high. TIBC will be low, opposite of iron deficiency anemia, and iron level will be reduce, and invariably you will see that saturation is more than 18. While in case of a sideroblastic anemia ferritin level is elevated because there is a storage, excessive storage of hemosiderin. TIBC level will be normal, iron level will be elevated. So you can see that in this particular it is opposite, exactly opposite of iron deficiency anemia. Ferritin is low, here it is high. Iron is low, iron is high. TIBC is elevated, here it is normal. And you will get sideroblast, ring sideroblast. And this ring sideroblast will be seen in bone marrow only. It cannot be seen in peripheral smear. Remember that. And same thing you can see here. In anemia of chronic disorders, TIBC is in opposite direction. So this helps you to differentiate. So TIBC becomes very, very useful to differentiate this microcytic hypochromic anemia, which is there in iron deficiency, thalassemia, anemia of chronic disorders, and sideroblastic. In iron deficiency, it is elevated. In thalassemia and sideroblastic, it is close to normal. While in anemia of chronic disease, TIBC is low. This becomes a very, very important to differentiate those conditions. And another thing which will help you is iron level. Iron level will be high in sideroblastic, while it will be low in case of iron deficiency anemia and anemia of chronic disorders or chronic disease. Now because if in some patient there is an iron deficiency anemia along with chronic inflammation. This becomes little difficult. Because of iron deficiency, iron level will be low. TIBC will be low, which is normally high in case of iron deficiency. Now, this becomes an important clue that in presence of low iron level, low ferritin level, if TIBC is low, then do suspect iron deficiency is there with anemia of chronic inflammation. This becomes an important clue. So, ferritin level in that particular person may be low or may be high. High will be because of what we call as anemia of chronic duration. So, if anemia is because of a chronic disorders, then ferritin level may be elevated. So, if TIBC is low in case of iron deficiency, do suspect it is may be associated with anemia of chronic inflammation or chronic disease. So, it becomes a very useful. This I am skipping over. There is a little difference in a thalassemia major and thalassemia minor. I am not talking in detail. I'll just mention two things. Bone marrow iron stores will be absent in case of iron deficiency, while usually there will be some amount of bone marrow storage, and they will be little higher in case of sideroblastic anemia and in case of anemia of chronic inflammation. In thalassemia also, the bone marrow storage is reduced and hemoglobin electrophoresis will be very, very helpful in case of thalassemia, while it will be normal because there is no defect in a hemoglobin manufacture in case of iron deficiency or chronic inflammation or in case of a sideroblastic anemia. And if you look in peripheral smear, if you get basophil stipplings and you get a ring pigmentation in bone marrow, it is in favor of sideroblastic anemia, which is very, very helpful. So, these are the additional bone marrow studies. So, that is bone marrow biopsy and study of bone marrow biopsy. If you get a ring sideroblast, it will be in favor of sideroblastic anemia, and hemoglobin electrophoresis will be helpful in case of thalassemia to find out thalassemia trait and thalassemia major. There is one another material which is being calculated, which is not commonly being asked, is called soluble transferrin receptor. In iron deficiency, it will be elevated, while in case of a chronic inflammation or anemia of chronic disease, it will be normal. Very, very important. So, do look for this. If still you find a difficulty whether anemia is because of iron deficiency or because of chronic inflammation, that in presence of iron deficiency, if soluble transferrin receptor level is normal, it is that person is having probably iron deficiency anemia with anemia of chronic inflammation or chronic duration or chronic disease. In case of iron overload, depending upon the serum ferritin level, you can mention that mild, moderate and severe. If it is serum ferritin level is less than 2500, we call it as a mild. Between 2500 to 500, we call as moderate, and more than 500, we call as a severe. And this is very frequently seen in case of a hemochromatosis. A second investigation which can help you in identifying a iron overload, particularly in case of a hemosiderosis and hemochromatosis, that is cardiac T2 MRI scan. And that will help you to differentiate what we call as an iron overload. So, do keep it in mind. So, in case of an iron overload, ferritin level will help you a lot. If ferritin level and iron level are markedly elevated, it is more in favor of hemochromatosis. Iron level will be also elevated in case of an acute liver injury. But iron level will be reduced in case of acute phase reactant, where ferritin level will be elevated but iron level will be low. If you come across ferritin level normal and iron level is reduced, or even ferritin level is little high and iron level is reduced, it is more in favor of anemia of chronic inflammation. And if both are reduced, ferritin and iron is reduced, it is in favor of iron deficiency anemia. So, in case of Stored disorders, ferritin level is high, transferrin saturation is high, which also suggests iron overload. You will have to go for genetic study to find out HFE gene mutation. In liver biopsy, you will see by pearl stain, there is an excessive iron pigmentation. CT abdomen will show you increased attenuation of liver. MRI scan, we have already mentioned here that cardiac T2 MRI scan will give you an iron picture, and that will show you liver iron level as well as myocardial infiltration by hemochromatosis. So ferritin level will be high, serum iron level will be high, TIBC will be low, and iron saturation will be high. Straightforward goes in favor of hemochromatosis. So serum iron is high, ferritin is high, saturation is high, but transferrin level is low. This is classical in case of, or we call TIBC, in case of hemochromatosis. In case of iron deficiency, TIBC is high. In case of anemia of chronic disease, TIBC will be low and ferritin level will be high. And there is also one condition which also little bit changes the TIBC, that in during pregnancy and female who are on oral contraceptive pills, there is increased level of TIBC. Do keep it in mind. This can change your picture. So I end my lecture here. I thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable, and I appreciate you for spending some of the time with me. I think this iron study explanation, different values and different condition in which they are abnormal, will be very helpful to you in your everyday practice. And whenever you come across in a patient with anemia, particularly microcytic hypochromic anemia, do, if person is affording, do ask for iron study. It will help you to differentiate between iron deficiency, sideroblastic anemia of chronic disorders, and thalassemia trait. These four conditions you will be able to differentiate very easily by looking at the iron panel. And good number of times, this iron panel is also helpful if the person is not responding to iron therapy, and probably the person is having anemia of chronic disease associated with iron deficiency anemia. Person will not have a good response. In that case also, iron study will be very helpful, because usually in iron deficiency, I have shown you one slide, that in case of iron deficiency anemia, TIBC is elevated. This particular will be not common in case of iron deficiency anemia with anemia of chronic disease. And ferritin level will be elevated in anemia of chronic disease. But in iron deficiency anemia, ferritin level are low. So in presence of iron deficiency anemia, if TIBC is abnormal, normally we get TIBC low, ferritin also low, sorry, TIBC is high, and ferritin is low. Ferritin is low, iron level is low, and saturation is low. So if you get ferritin level high and TIBC level, which is supposed to be high, is low, do suspect there is something else, and very frequently you will come across anemia of chronic disease. So I end my lecture here. Again, I thank you for taking out time. And if you find this lecture is helpful, these lectures are all for educative purpose. This is very, very helpful to you in your everyday practice, and particularly in a person with anemia. And we come across iron deficiency anemia very, very common in our everyday practice. So I end my lecture here. I hope this lecture will be helpful to you.